Hello, welcome back. So thus far we have discussed the moral hazard problem, so the basic principal agent model and the relative performance evaluation and team incentives. In those discussion we considered the what is that the two big problems. One is the tension between insurance and incentive, and the other is the free riding problem. Today, we move on to a different topic, adverse selection. So I am pretty sure that you have heard of this term, adverse selection, but unfortunately, many people use this term in wrong way. So in this lecture, I'm going to explain what adverse selection means in economics, and I'm going to introduce a new model, which is called task allocation model. Okay. So, why do you want to discuss this adverse selection problem? Because we are following the Nobel Prize document, and in the Nobel Prize document, the first topic is the tension between insurance and incentive, and then we discuss the informativeness principle. And we discussed the team incentive, but we jumped the one topic which is called career concern. And to understand what the career concern means and to understand the model of career concern, we need to understand what adverse selection is. So that's why we are discussing this, and because we are, we want to understand what adverse selection is, I'm going to introduce a few models which are not discussed in the Nobel Prize document, but they are good to know. I mean, they are really important models in economics, and they give very important insights. So I think they are good to know. Okay, so what is adverse selection? So we want to understand situations in which some parties are not certain of characteristics of the other parties. So here is the difference. So moral hazard is the situation where there is an uncertainty about one's action. Okay. So for example, managers managers do not know how hard workers are working, and insurance companies do not know whether a driver carefully drove. So these are examples of moral hazard, and these are obviously very important topics, important problems, but there are other important problems as well. So adverse selection is a asymmetric information problem about the states. So here, states means, types or characteristics of other people. So, but we call it state because of the following reason. Imagine there are many universes, like multiverses, okay? And we don't know in which universe we are in. So in different universes, people are different. For example, in one universe, I like color red, and in different universe, I like color blue. But you don't. So and I know which color I like. So for example, I like red, but you don't know which color I like. So you don't know which universe you are in. Okay, in one universe, I like color red. In the other universe, I like color blue, but you don't know which universe or which state you are in. Okay, that's why we call it a uncertainty about states. Okay, so here are some examples. Sellers do not know buyers' willingness to pay. So buyers' willingness to pay is the private information of buyers. So there is asymmetric information problem about buyer's willingness to pay, which is sort of characteristics of a buyer, and or it's a type of the buyer. Okay, so there is uncertainty about type or the characteristics or the state. Okay, so the buyers do not know the true value of the product. So sellers know the value of the product, maybe the quality of the product is really high, so the value is really high, or maybe it's just a crap. But the buyers may not know the true value, the true quality of the product. Okay, so and oligopolies, the competing firms, do not know their rivals' cost. So the rivals' the production costs may be private information of their own. And negotiators do not know the opponent's value. So you know they try to figure out the opponent's value by making, you know, they experimenting different offers. And the government does not know the income of a taxpayer, you know, a specific taxpayer. Maybe they know some part of it, but you know, the information is not perfect. So the taxpayer's income is not completely observed by the government. So there is asymmetric information problem between the government and taxpayer, and the asymmetric information is about taxpayer's income. So taxpayer's income is sort of taxpayer's type or characteristic. Okay, so this is the adverse selection problem, and obviously it's very prevalent, and you can find it very easily in reality, and as we'll see later, it's very important. It has a huge impact on people's economic behavior. Okay, here again, we are going to see that this concept, incentive compatibility, is really important. So you know where this is. So this is the, you know, front yard of Daewoo Hall, and you see the red circle in the center of the picture. You see there is a, let's say, unofficial way to climb up to Daewoo Hall, right? You can see the official way on the left, but people do not use that road. People do not use that way, walkway, very often. Instead, most people use the unofficial road, unofficial walkway, which is circled in at the center. So, what's the problem? The problem is the designer of this space didn't take into account the incentive of the users, the incentive of the participants, the incentives of people when he or she designed this space. So this is an example of failure of considering incentive compatibility. So if incentive compatibility is not taken into account, or if the incentive of the participants are not taken into account, then the contract or the design will fail. Okay, the goal will not be achieved. So this is a visual illustration of such failure. So here again, we are going to discuss adverse selection, but you will see that this incentive compatibility is also very important in our discussion on adverse selection. Okay, so we are going to consider three models. The first model is the task collocation. So in task collocation model, we'll consider one employer and two workers, and the employer has two tasks. Okay, so there are two tasks or two jobs, and one job, one task is easy task, the other task is a difficult task, and the manager has to allocate which task to whom, to which worker. But the manager does not know who has the personality, talent, etc., good for the difficult task. So there is asymmetric information problem about the productivity of worker. So the workers know their own productivity or their own personality or talent, but the manager does not know their talent. So that's the problem. So the manager has to allocate efficient worker to a difficult task and inefficient worker to an easy task, and that's the goal. But the problem is the manager does not know the talent of each worker. So that's the task allocation problem. And then and next we'll consider the price discrimination model and the auction model. Here there is one seller, monopolist, who will sell some good. So the problem is the seller does not know the willingness to pay of the buyers, and so the seller has to design an allocation rule and a pricing scheme that maximizes the profit without knowing the willingness to pay of the buyers. So there are two cases. In one case, there is no limitation in providing the product. So, you know, the seller is basically the producer, so the seller can produce the good as much as possible, you know, as much as she wants. In that case, we are going to consider the price discrimination model. But if there is some limitation in supply, like if there is let's say, you know, let's consider a Picasso painting. Obviously Picasso is dead, so the, you know, Picasso painting is with limited supply. In that case, we will have to consider an auction model. Okay, so if there is limitation in supply, then we will consider auction model. If there is no limitation in supply, then we consider a price discrimination model. So in total, we consider three models. These are very basic models of adverse selection, and they give very similar insights, which is this. So lessons to learn. When facing agents of unknown types, the principal will distort some of the transactions to meet the incentive constraints, the incentive compatibility constraints. More specifically, to earn a higher revenue from the top, by top I mean, you know, the buyer with higher value, or the worker who will generate higher value, or efficient type, or the rich. So that's what I mean by the top. So to earn higher revenue from the top, the principal typically distorts lower value transactions. Here is an example, a really good example. So let's consider an economy class in airplane. So as everybody knows, the economy class is really, you know, small. The seats are really small. Is, you know, it's really tight, uncomfortable. Maybe you want to increase the space, you expand the space, and pay a little bit more. You know, probably many people are willing to do that, but still, the and maybe, you know, by doing that, the, you know, the airlines can earn higher revenue, but the airlines do not want to do that, because if the economy class seats become bearable, you know, if economy class seats becomes too comfortable, then the people who are using business class or the first class will deviate to the economy class. They will not use the business class or the first class. So in order to earn higher revenue from the top, from the rich, the airlines must make the economy class really horrible, really uncomfortable. So that's the idea. Here is another example, the student version of a software. This is really, you know, weird, ridiculous, you know, if you think about it. You know, the software companies, the developers make a software, the full version of software, and they degrade it. You know, they eliminate some functionalities and make a student version of the software. You know, if you think about the social, you know, surplus which can generate, which can be generated by this software, then there is no point of make the good worse, right? You know, if the good is good enough, I mean the software is good enough, then everybody's willingness pay will be higher. You know, everybody's willingness pay for the full version of the software will be higher than the student version of the software, which is inferior in its functionality, or, you know, I don't know. So it's ridiculous, but still the developers or the software companies still make a student version of a software. The reason is, you know, they want to differentiate the market, so they want to segregate the market. So, you know, there are people who want to use the full version of the software and has money to pay. So there are rich people who are willing to pay a lot for a good software, and there are poor people, let's say students, who are not so rich, and they their willingness to pay is not very high. So to prevent a deviation to the student version of the software, they have to the software companies has to make the student version worse. Okay, so that's the idea. So in order to prevent the deviation of the rich, the software companies or the airlines typically distort the low value transaction. Typically they lower the quality of the good. Okay, so that's the lesson, that's the pattern that we'll see in the following discussions. Okay, so yeah, test collocation problem. Here we have an employer or the manager, the principal, has two tasks to be allocated to workers. So the revenue from task I is written like this: Ri equals alpha I plus beta I times A. Here alpha and beta are some given numbers. We don't know what they are, but you know, they are just given numbers. Okay, and A is the effort. So if A is high, then the revenue is high. So if the worker works a lot, then the revenue will be high. And you may notice that there is no epsilon or whatsoever, so there is no random factor. So alpha I is just some known number, so it's not noise. So here we, as you can see, we don't have the noise. which means we will not consider the moral hazard problem. And we'll assume that beta 1 is smaller than beta 2, which means task 1 is easier in the sense that the effort level matters less than task 2. So in task 2, if you put a lot of effort in task 2, then the revenue increases a lot, but not for task 1. So that's not the case for task 1. So the if you are doing task 1, then the effort matters less. So in that sense, you know, the task 2 is a difficult task. So let me explain those terms a little bit more. So imagine two types of task. One is you know, selling some stuffs in a convenience store. There are manuals, there are you know, very detailed job descriptions, so you are supposed to this and that in some specific time, and you don't have to be very creative. You know, you just do what you have to do. You know, everything is written in the contract. So that's what I mean by easy task. Obviously, that's not that may be difficult, that may be challenging physically, but the intentional effort level is, the intentional effort is not much required. So you just follow the order, you just follow what you are supposed to do, you just do what you are supposed to do. Okay, so that's like task 1. Another task, task 2, the other task, task 2, is like some creative job. So you have to figure out some problems and you have to solve the problems. To solve the problem, you have to be creative and you have to put much effort intentionally. You spend your time day and night, and then the output can be improved a lot by your effort, your intentional effort. That's like task 2. Okay, so maybe these terms, easy and difficult, are not really right, but what I mean is, in one task, you don't have to put much intentional effort. In the other task, you have to put much intentional effort. Okay, so that's the difference. And that idea is captured by this assumption that beta 1 is smaller than beta 2. So and for convenience, we'll call the first task, task 1, an easy task, and task 2, a difficult task. Okay, so the task 1 is the easy task, and task 2 is the difficult task. Next assumption, the principal's payoff looks like this: revenue minus wage, and revenue minus wage. So AI is the effort exerted by worker employed for task I. And AI is verifiable, thus contractable, which means there is no moral hazard problem. Obviously, in reality, there will be moral hazard problem, but we will put it aside. We'll just focus on the adverse selection problem. We'll just tackle the adverse selection problem. We tackle one problem by one. Okay. So WI is the wage given to the worker employed for task I. So the principal's payoff is revenue minus wage plus revenue minus wage. Principal recruits the workers by posting the effort wage pairs. So this is basically the contract. So this is the written contract. So what's written on the contract, and they are posted, which means everybody can see them. So A1 is effort required for task 1, and wage W1, and A2 is the effort required for task 2, and W2 is the wage given for the task 2. So they are determined. They are posted. They are determined by the principal. And because there is no asymmetric information problem, the effort will be just A1 and A2. Okay? So efforts are determined by the principal. And the workers just decide whether to apply for the job. And if they decide to apply for the jobs, and they decide which job they apply for. Okay? So there are two tasks, task 1 and task 2. Job description and wage, everything are written in the contract. What they have to do is they just decide which job they apply for. And type J workers pay off when hired for task I can be written like this. WI is the wage minus CJ of AI. So CJ means the cost function of type J worker is maybe different from the cost function of type I worker or type K worker. Okay, so I is for task and J is for worker. So effort level is chosen by the principal, and so the agent's choice is which task to apply for, and CJ of A is a quadratic function. So this is just a little bit of abuse of notation. So it can be written like CJ is some number, some known number, times A squared. So it's a quadratic function which is multiplied by this some number C. And two workers in the market. So there are only two workers. Okay? So you know, the principal has to hire these two workers because she has two jobs, two tasks. So she has to hire these two workers. And she knows that one worker is efficient and the other worker is inefficient. Maybe we can call them productive and unproductive or less productive. Okay? So the first one is an inefficient worker. So the first one is less productive worker, which is expressed like this. C1 is greater than C2. So C1 is greater than C2 means that the effort cost is larger for type 1 worker than type 2 worker. Okay, type 2 worker is an efficient worker, so the cost, the effort cost is lower than the type 1 worker. And it is known that one worker is type 1 and the other worker is type 2. So there are only two workers in the market, and one worker is type 1 worker and the other worker is type 2 worker. Okay? And regardless of type of the workers, the worker's reservation payoff is zero. So these are just descriptions or the assumptions of the model, and we move on to the analysis. So first, full information benchmark, or the first best case. If the principal knows the type of the workers, then the principal can give this contract A1 W1 A2 W2 that leaves no surplus to the workers. So what that means is the principal just give individual contract. So it works like this. I know you are the efficient worker, so you work as much as A2, and then I will pay W2. And for the other worker, the principal says, I know you are the inefficient worker, so you work as much as A1 and I will pay W1. So it's individual specific contract, and you know, and they will accept it. And I mean, the workers will accept the offer, and they will work as much as A1 and A2. And this is a way to maximize the social surplus. This is as what we have seen in other models, like the basic principal agent model or the relative performance evaluation model. The idea is the agent gets zero surplus or the fixed surplus. So if the principal increase the pie, then the principal takes the entire surplus. So the principal's profit or the principal's expected utility coincides with the social surplus. So the principal maximizes the expected profit or the expected utility, and by doing so, the principal maximizes the social surplus. Okay? So the principal maximizes the following objective function, R1 minus W1 plus R2 minus W2. Subject 2, two constraints. The first one reads like this, W1 minus C1 times A1 squared must be greater than 0. And W2 minus C2 times A2 squared must be greater than or equal to 0. So these two constraints are the participation constraints, right? The left-hand side, you see the expected utility of the workers, and right-hand side, you see the reservation payoff, which is 0. So if the expected utility of participation is greater than or equal to the reservation payoff, then the workers will apply for the job, and they will participate in the contract. And these constraints must be binding, and if you solve this problem with these two binding IR constraints, then you have this solution, AIFB, the first best, equals beta I over 2CI. So these are the solutions. So these are the optimal effort level. These are the effort level which maximize the principal's expected profit, and at the same time the effort which maximize the social surplus. Okay, so this is the first best benchmark. Let me explain a little bit more about how to solve this model. So the IR the first step is this: the IR constraints must be binding. Why is that? Suppose that the IR constraints are not binding, then IR constraints hold as strict inequalities. For example, W1 minus C1 times A1 squared must be greater than 0, strictly greater than 0. And these OPT, you know, superscript OPT, opt, means these are the optimal wage and optimal effort. So these are the wage and effort that maximize the expected profit. And you know, this W1 opt minus C1 times A1 opt squared must be strictly greater than 0. Then the employer can, but the employer can increase the profit by reducing the wage slightly. So let's look at the second inequality. So W1 opt minus epsilon minus C1 times A1 opt squared may be greater than or equal to 0 if epsilon is very small. And we know that we can find very, very small epsilon which makes this inequality holds. What that means is the original solution, so a1 opt comma w1 opt was not maximizing the profit. So this is a contradiction, right? So we assume that the IR constraints are not binding, and we assume that w1 opt and a1 opt are optimal wage and optimal effort. But what we found is these are not actually maximizing the profit. These are not optimal. What that means is the IR constraints must be binding, because you know the assumption must be wrong. So the IR constraints must be binding. You are probably now familiar with this argument, so I'm not going to explain anymore. So the IR constraints must be binding, which means the objective function of the principle can be written like this: R1 minus W1 plus R2 minus W2 can be written like alpha 1 plus beta 1 times A1 minus C1 times A1 squared plus alpha 2 plus beta 2 times A2 minus C2 times A2 squared. So now these are just functions of A1 and A2. So you can differentiate these this objective function with respect to A1 and A2. Then you'll have these first order conditions, these derivatives on the left hand side. So beta 1 is the marginal benefit of increasing A1, and 2 times C1 times A1 is the marginal cost. So you have to increase the wage as much as 2 times C1 times A1. So at the optimum, the marginal benefit must be same with the marginal cost. So beta 1 must be same with 2 times C1 times A1. So if you solve this solve these equations, then you get this result at the bottom: A1 FB equals beta 1 over C 2 C1, and A2 FB first best equals beta 2 over 2 C2. Okay, so this is the full information benchmark, the first best case. Okay, let's move on to the the main model, more interesting case, hidden type situation, or the second best situation. Here, the principal does not know the worker's type, so the principal has to make the workers select the right task. So the principal has to design the contract well, optimally. So the workers select the right task. And what that means is that it must be the workers' best interest choose the right task. How does that work? Let's look at the problem, the principal's problem. The principal maximizes the objective function, the profit, which is R1 minus W1 plus R2 minus W2. Subject to four constraints. We now have four constraints. Okay. What are these constraints? The first two are the IC constraints, or the incentive compatibility constraints, and the last two constraints are the IR constraints, or the participation constraints, right? So let's look at the first constraint, the very first constraint. W1 minus C1 times A1 squared must be greater than or equal to W2 minus C1 times A2 squared. So the left-hand side is the expected utility of the worker, type 1 worker, who works for task 1. And on the right-hand side, excuse me, on the right-hand side, it is the expected utility of type 1 worker who works in task works for task 2. Okay, so W2 is the wage given for the task 2, and A2 is the effort level required for task 2. But this cost parameter C is C1. So we are talking about type 1 worker. And it's same for the it's similar for the second constraint. So it's the IC constraint for the incentive constraint for the type 2 worker, right? So the type 2 worker is better off by choosing task 2. So type 1 worker is better off by choosing task 1, and type 2 worker is better off by choosing task 2. And the next two the last two constraints are the participation constraints that we just saw in the first best case. Okay, so we have four constraints: two IR constraints, two IC constraints, and it's a difficult problem. And the first step to solve this problem is to figure out which constraints are binding. Okay, which constraints are binding? The first thing you can notice is that the IR constraint for the efficient worker is not binding. You can see that from this. If you just look at it, you can see that the IR constraint for the efficient worker is not binding. If you have a very good eyes, bright eyes, clear eyes, then you can see that the IR constraint for the efficient worker is not binding. Can you see it? Okay, let me explain. So the look at the top the very first inequality. So W2 minus C2 times A2 squared must be greater than or equal to W1 minus C2 times A1 squared. So this is the IC constraint for the efficient worker, the type 2 worker. Okay, type 2 workers incentive constraint is written at the top. And in the next line, I replaced C2 by C1. And C2 is smaller than C1, so we have this inequality. So W1 minus C2 times A1 squared must be greater than W1 minus C1 times A1 squared. Okay, because C1 is larger than C2, we have this inequality. And W1 minus C1 times A1 squared is the expected utility of inefficient worker, and it must be greater than or equal to 0. So this is the IR constraint for the inefficient worker, the type 1 worker. Type 1 worker's IR constraint is written at the in the second line. Okay, so what's the conclusion? The conclusion is W2 minus C2 times A2 squared is greater than 0, strictly greater than 0. What that means is the IR constraint for the efficient worker is not binding. Okay, the IR constraint for the efficient worker is not binding. So we are left with the other three constraints: the two IC constraints and one IR constraint. There are still many possibilities. Maybe all three of them are binding. Maybe only two of them, maybe just one, and if only two of them are binding, then we have to figure out which constraints are binding and which one is not. How exactly can we do that? Let's look at this diagram. So so x-axis is W1 and y-axis is W2. So we take A1 and A2 as given. In other words, we just fix A1 and A2 and we draw these constraints, IR constraints and IC constraints on this plane, W1, W2 plane. Okay? So IR1 or the IR constraint for the inefficient worker can be written like this. So W1 must be large enough, otherwise the so W1 is large enough so that the effort cost for the inefficient worker is compensated. Otherwise, the inefficient worker will not participate in the contract. The inefficient worker will reject the offer. So W1 must be large enough. So in this diagram, in this plane, you can see that there is a vertical line, and the IR1 requires that the W1 and W2 must be on the right hand side, the right side of this vertical line. Okay, so that's IR1. What about IC1 and IC2? So in this diagram, in this picture, you see the y-axis is W2 and the x-axis is W1. So I just put W2 on the left hand side of the inequalities and W1 and everything else on the right hand side. Here IC1 requires that W2 shouldn't be too large, otherwise the low type worker, so inefficient worker, deviates to task 2. Okay, so W2 shouldn't be too large, so W2 must be below this 45 degree line, which I call IC1 line. So W2 must be small enough so that W2 must be small enough so that the inefficient worker chooses task 1. That's what IC1 requires. What about IC2? IC2 requires that W2 must be large enough, otherwise the efficient worker will deviate to task 1. Okay, so let me explain it more graphically. So this is IR1. Okay, so W1 must be large enough, otherwise the inefficient worker will not participate in the contract. This is IC2, right? So W2 must be large enough, otherwise the efficient worker will deviate to task 1. And this is IC1. So W2 shouldn't be too large. Okay? As you can see, all three constraints are satisfied, all three requirements are satisfied in this area, in this green area, all three requirements are satisfied. Okay, so we will focus on this area, this green area. The next step is, okay, so it's good to know. So W1 and W2 must be in this green area, but we want to figure out which constraints are binding. Is it IR1 and IC1 or IR1 and IC2? You know, but we are sure that we know that it is not possible that IC1 and IC2 hold as equality at the same time. Okay, that's not possible because they are parallel. They never meet each other. They never intersect each other. So it's like, you know, either IL1 and IC1. That's one possibility. Or IL1 and IC2. That's another possibility. But it's not possible that IC1 and IC2 hold as equality at the same time because they are parallel. They never meet each other. Okay? So this is the constraint set, right? So it's like body set. You know, we have this constraint, let's say body set, and you know, in the basic microeconomics course, we have a budget set, and we have the indifference curve, and you know, at some point the utility is maximized. Okay, so in the utility maximization problem, we have a triangular budget set, and we have a round indifference curve. And we want to push the indifference curve outward, you know, as much as possible. We push out the indifference curve, and the utility is maximized when the indifference curve meets the body set. You know, if they are tangent, right? So that's the optimal point. Here is similar. We are going to draw isoprofit curve instead of indifference curve. We are going to draw isoprofit curve. What is isoprofit curve? Isoprofit curve is a trajectory of point in which the profit is same. So, for example, the profit is R1 minus W1 plus R2 minus W2, and let's say it is pi. Pi is some number, okay? Let's say 10, okay? Pi is 10. And we can draw this curve on this W1 and W2 space. So it can be written like this, right? So W2 equals minus W1 plus R1 plus R2 minus pi. So pi is some number, and R1 and R2 are some given numbers because we fixed A1 and A2. So these R1, R2, pi are just some given numbers. So then we have this negative relationship between W1 and W2. So if you increase W1, then you have to reduce W2 to make the profit the same. So the isoprofit curve will look like this, right? So it's basically isoprofit line, or like this, and or like this. So and you can see that the isoprofit curve looks like this, and the profit increases as W1 and W2 decrease. Okay, so what that means is profit is maximized in this point, in this black dot, right? So the profit increases as the isoprofit curve shifts inward, and the profit will be maximized in this black dot. So what that means is if the principal wants to maximize the profit, then the IL1 and IC2 must be binding. So that's the conclusion. So IL1 and IC2 must be binding, and we are going to maximize the profit, the objective function of the principal, taking these two binding IL1 and IC2 constraints. Okay. So this is what we are going to do next, and we will see that in next lecture. Okay, that's it for today. Thanks. Bye.